Good morning. Good morning. We on? Hello. Good morning. Are we on yet? I don't think we're on yet. Are we?
Yeah, we are.
We are? I'm sorry. I didn't get plugged in yet. There. Now I can hear that I'm on. Welcome to the 10 a.m. worship service. We saw a few of you walk in about 9 o'clock there and then kind of like, oh, that's right, and then turn around and find something else to do. Our worship team also was not immune to that, so some of us were here early this morning. Please stand with us. Let's sing together.
Amazing grace.
Amen. We worship the King of Glory this morning. You may be seated. I'd like to welcome you to Stillwater E-Free. If this is your first time, we have a connection card inside your bulletin, or if you consider yourself relatively new and you haven't yet filled that out, we would love to know that you're here and just be able to connect with you. So, I think it's a tear-off. You can either put it in the offering boxes at the back of the sanctuary on your way out, or just leave it in your seat and someone will collect that. We'd love to hear from you. I have a prop this morning. It's the activity bags. I don't know what their official name is for this, but these are out now again, okay? So if you have kids who are going to be sitting through the service and they'd like an activity bag, I think they're somewhere out by the front door. So if you go out there and start looking around, I think you'll be able to find these. And also, just a reminder that Children's Church does begin today. So right after the music is done, before the sermon, between those, I think there's going to be a slide up there that's saying that the kids are going to be dismissed for Children's Church. Also, Jackie had surgery on Friday, and she's now recovering. She appreciates that everyone's given her a little bit of space for that recovery. Obviously, Pastor Nick is in contact with her, and we'll have an update for you midweek. But Pastor Nick told me to say that if there are any mistakes in here, it's definitely on him. It's totally his fault. So he gave me permission to say that. Let's see. We also wanted to call attention to the church parking lot repairs June 6th through 9th. Please, no one in the parking lot the 6th through the 9th. That's Monday through Thursday. Not this week, but the week after, right? So that won't affect the Sunday service, as it says here in the bulletin. And lastly, we need help with volunteers for Children's Church in particular. You have a QR code there. My understanding is we still need a volunteer or two, or I don't know, four or whatever, for even next week. So if anyone would like to volunteer, even for next week, that would be really, really helpful. Can't do this without volunteers. So please consider volunteering for Children's Church. I think that's it. Did I forget anything? A few more than normal. I think that was it. Let's remain seated. We have a different kind of call to worship. We have it on video from one of our members, Dave Ratty. So Dave is going to lead us in the call to worship.
Of Memorial Day, it is fitting that today's call to worship comes from Romans 5:6-8. For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 5:6-8.
Amen. So Paul is reasoning in Romans 5 that there are those who are willing to die for others. Scarcely. Not many of us would be willing to. And usually it's only for a righteous person, but God shows his love in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let's stand and sing in response.
He should give his own son.
you, O Lord. God invites us. This is a great mystery, isn't it? And it's something that we celebrate every Sunday morning. And we're celebrating it again a bit more explicitly, that He is inviting us, every single one of us.
Thank you.
Jesus, we hear your invitation again this morning. Come, ye sinners, weak and weary, wounded, broken. We hear your invitation, and in the song we hear an explanation as well. The incarnate God came and took on our sin. And by faith we are now united to him. And then when he ascended, our lives have already ascended into heaven with him. Our lives are already hidden with Christ and God up there. And so we're invited even now to come freely and boldly and with confidence, not in our own good works. Let no other trust intrude, but in your final work, Lord Jesus, and in your grace and mercy toward us freely offered. Help us to receive this good news again today, and help us to come to you, worshiping you freely and truly in response. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated.
Amen. Thank you, worship team, and welcome to all of you, whether you're here in person, whether you're joining us online like Dave Rattay was. It was kind of fun. We've had that plan for a while to just have him open with a call to worship just because he is one, you know, he's someone that is a longtime member here that's doing this this trip, but is following every week, and he signs in, and he tells us, and mainly that's Jackie and I and stuff that see those, but where he's at and things like that, so it's fun to have him here. But thank you for joining us as we start our summer hours. There might have been a few people that swung through the parking lot at 9 and then, you know, went out for coffee and then came back at 10. We thank you if you did that. We'll be meeting at 10 for the remainder of the summer. I think about summer and summer trips. It started when I was a boy, and then continued on in my teen years and high school into college, and even after I got married, was that my dad and I would typically go in the summer, and for a while it was every 2 years, but then got to be every year, that we would go out to Glacier National Park together, father-son time, for maybe a week, maybe 10 days or something like that, to camp and hike and fish and do some backpacking and things. And one of one of our favorite things to do would be to hike different trails that went up to the Continental Divide. So the Continental Divide goes through the Rockies and Glacier National Park, and it's always fun to think about, especially if you're on a trail that happens to walk the ridgeline or the actual divide itself, and you think, you know, if I pour my water bottle off on this side, it's going to go, to the Pacific Ocean. If I pour it on this side, it's going to go to the Atlantic Ocean. I mean, in reality, it just goes right into that super dry ground. But at least in your mind, it's sort of fun to think about that as walking on this great divide. Well, where we're at in the Gospel of Mark, as we've been studying as a church since we started in September, we're going to continue on through these summer days here, these summer Sundays, is that we really just entered chapter 8, and the middle of chapter 8 is the great divide. It is the center point of Mark's gospel. And it centers on this confession of Peter and the disciples when he says, "You are the Christ. You are the Christ." Now, when you're walking a ridge walk, especially on the Great Divide, you don't want to trip. But there's two stumbling blocks that show up here right after Peter and the disciples make this great confession about Jesus being the Messiah. The stumbling blocks are what the Messiah truly means, what the Messiah came to do and what he must be. It was not what the disciples were originally thinking. And then secondly, another stumbling block was what it meant to be a true disciple, what a true disciple must do. We are going to look at those two things this morning from Mark chapter 8, verses 31 through 9, verse 1, as we finish out this chapter. If you have your scriptures with, I'd ask you to open up to Mark chapter 8, starting verse 31. Otherwise, on the back of your bulletin and on the screen, you'll be able to pick us up. Here we are reading from the Word of God, Mark chapter 8, verse 31. "And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed. And after 3 days, rise again. And he said plainly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter. And he said, 'Get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man.' And then calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said to them, 'If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of the Father with his holy angels.' And he said to them, 'Truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the kingdom of God after it has come with power.'" Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for an opportunity to meet together. We think of the freedoms we are afforded in this country, and many of them because of people willing to make a sacrifice for this country that's similar to what you talk about as a sacrifice of a true disciple. And on this weekend, as we think of those things, I pray that you would bring these truths deeper into our hearts. That following you as king means self-denial. It means self-sacrifice. It means a lot of difficult things, stumbling blocks to this world. And I pray as we dig into your word that you would speak clearly, as you say here, speak plainly to our hearts and to our ears. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, friends, I understand that when we gather here together on Sunday for worship, there are certain expectations that govern our time together. It's understood that we will pray, that we'll lift our voices in praise and thanksgiving to the Lord of creation, that we will read from the Holy Word of God, carefully consider it, and think about how it applies to our lives. And only slightly less important to that, we have this standing expectation that there will be no math, right? That you will not have to do any math when you get here. So I want to tell you right now, as you look at the title of the sermon for today, you do not need to fear. You will not need that TI-82 graphing calculator that you bought as a junior in high school. By the way, I don't know if this is, so, you know, I was in high school a long time ago. I turned, 42 this summer. And those things cost like $80 when I was a, a sophomore or junior in high school. And it's like, it's one thing that you just can't throw away. And I finally got rid of it after the renovation, and I removed back into my office. I said, finally, I'm done with the graphing calculators, by the way. But you do not need the graphing calculator today. We won't be doing addition or subtraction this morning, but we will be talking about the upside-down math of the kingdom, the upside-down economics of following Jesus, the addition by subtraction that happens in the kingdom of God. We hear this often in the words of Jesus, the last shall be first and the first shall be last. Blessed are those who mourn. For those who have left home and father and mother for me will be blessed in the eternal kingdom. There's many more of these things that don't make sense on this earth, but make sense in the economics of the kingdom of God. Now, in most cases, that phrase addition by subtraction is nonsensical. In most cases, addition and subtraction are antithetical to one another. But then again, all of us can think of cases in our lives where that idiom of addition by subtraction has been proven true. I was thinking about that, something that I heard on the radio long ago, listening to sports radio here in the Twin Cities. It was the 1500 station. And it was back after the 2015 NFL season. And the wide receiver, Calvin Johnson, who is arguably one of the best to ever play the game, retired from the Detroit Lions. And there was a lot of scuttle and talk about, what that was going to mean for the division, for the Lions. And there was some local guy, and I don't know who it was, that made this comment that he believed the Lions were going to get better with losing this, Hall of Fame wide receiver, the best. And they played that. They cut that clip, and they would play it in their advertisements and things like just making fun of this guy. Like, this is the most ridiculous take ever. Well, unbelievably, what happened is the Lions did get better as a team. They won more games the next year. The quarterback had a better rating. Everything sort of went better with losing this player. There's a lot of reasons why we could parse out why that might be, but it is this strange example of addition by subtraction. Maybe in your personal life you've seen addition by subtraction. You subtract something from your monthly budget, eliminate something from your busy schedule, maybe even something that you really enjoy and it seems painful to cut out at the time. But unexpectedly, the increase in time or the money or whatever happens from cutting that out is a gain to your well-being. It's addition by subtraction. Many of you know that I was very involved in Campus Crusade for Christ in college. Now it's called CRU, but I can remember back to when we would go on some of these bigger ministry trips that you'd kind of go through the expectations that there were. And one of the few things in crew that could get you sent home like that was having a divisive or a contentious spirit. You'd look through and a lot of other things that might happen when you're on a ministry trip, those could be dealt with, within the confines of the group and when you're there. But one thing that was not tolerated was a quarreling or divisive spirit. And so it was addition by subtraction. And again, just thinking of this weekend and this day outside the Bible and the example of Jesus, maybe the clearest picture of addition by subtraction is what we celebrate in Memorial Day weekend. So we remember the men, the women who have given their lives to protect ours, given their life to protect the freedoms that allow us to flourish with religious and civil liberties. Addition by subtraction. But on a spiritual level, Addition by subtraction was something that the disciples of Jesus needed to understand. The Messiah would come to power, and his kingdom would come not by force, but by suffering. And this following Jesus, a disciple of Jesus, would serve him not in earthly power, but with sacrifice. The kingdom would be marked by addition, by subtraction. So I want to take our time this morning to consider how this passage teaches us about the upside-down math of the kingdom of God. Now, as we mentioned, our passage begins on the heels of Peter's and the disciples' great confession in verse 29, and he asked them. Again, you know, oftentimes we think of this as Peter, but it's really clear in Mark that these are, Peter's a spokesperson, but all the disciples are in the same boat here, are saying the same thing. And he asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" And Peter answered, "You are the Christ." Matthew puts a little more detail. It says, Simon Peter replied to Jesus' question, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you. Reason has not given this to you, but my Father who is in heaven." As we mentioned last week, this is the point that the disciples' eyes are beginning to see. They've correctly identified Jesus as the promised Messiah from the Old Testament, the anointed one, the deliverer, the Savior that is to come. But just like that blind man from Bethsaida, they did not yet see with clarity. They still saw men as trees walking. Peter and the disciples had identified the correct title for Jesus, but at the same time, they had almost no idea what it really meant to be the Christ, the Son of the living God. And so Jesus begins his next teaching by explaining plainly about how the Son of Man must suffer, be rejected, and be killed. Now, a few things that stand out in these opening verses is first, the title that Jesus uses to self-identify. You know, take a moment, if you'd like to, and just, in verse 31, you could circle that title, Son of Man. Or maybe if you have your notes, circling that title, the Son of Man. You know, we see that title a lot in the Gospels, but we haven't really talked about it much up here, definitely not at all so far in Mark. Now, we know Jesus is the Christ, the promised Messiah. He has just been correctly identified that way by Peter and the disciples. But it's interesting that when speaking to the followers and to the crowds that were there, virtually the next verse, Jesus doesn't use the term Christ for himself. He reverts back to his preferred title, the Son of Man. Matter of fact, Jesus refers to himself as the Son of Man more than any other title in the Gospels. So I think it's important to take a moment just to consider what that means. Now, the title Son of Man is used in the Old Testament in two different ways. First, and most commonly, it's used to refer simply to human beings. For instance, in the book of Ezekiel, if you read through the book of Ezekiel, you're going to see that term all the time. It's used over 90 times in the book of Ezekiel to refer to the prophet. Likewise, you see it in Job and Isaiah and in Numbers. The Son of Man, most of the time in the Old Testament, is simply a term for a person, a mortal. But secondly, and this is only one place in the Old Testament, but it is a very, very prominent place in the Old Testament. The term Son of Man is also used in Daniel chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. It's to describe a divine being who has the appearance and form of a man, but dwells in heaven with the Ancient of Days. It says this, "I saw in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, there came one like the Son of Man. And he came to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. And to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him, his dominion, an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom, one that shall not be destroyed." And so in the Old Testament, you have these two sort of opposite or very separate views of the definition of Son of Man. In one sense, it's just a regular person. In the other, it is the promised Messiah. What's interesting then, and why I believe that Jesus preferred this term, is that when people heard Jesus use the title Son of Man for himself, there was some intentional ambiguity in it. When Jesus used the term Son of Man, it was almost an invitation for people to start deciding what picture of the Son of Man this guy really was. Was he a godly human preaching the words of Yahweh like Ezekiel did? Or might he be that messianic figure who dwells with the Ancient of Days and has come to usher in an everlasting dominion? But technically speaking, he was both. He was 100% man, 100% God. But it took faith to believe that Jesus was like the Son of Man in Daniel. And I believe that Jesus preferred title of the Son of Man in his ministry. He did that not only because, and it definitely was partly this, because it had less political and military connotations attached to it than Christ or Messiah did. But primarily, it was a way to be a continual invitation to a deeper faith and trust in him. A continual question of, do you see me as a prophet? A good teacher in line with Ezekiel? Or do you see me as the one who dwells with Yahweh and will usher in an eternal kingdom of righteousness? Next, we notice that according to verse 32, Jesus is now speaking plainly. Speaking plainly about his suffering, death, and resurrection. Now that stands out because, as we've seen reading through Mark and other Gospels, that actually was not Jesus' typical way of teaching. What people often think about Jesus, he taught in parables, and it was a way of making things easy for people to understand. But no, when Jesus tells why he taught in parables, he actually says it's a way of him speaking in riddles. Jesus often proclaimed deep truths that were somewhat shrouded and could not be fully understood without some amount of spiritual intervention. But this truth was too important to misunderstand. And so Jesus spoke repetitively and clearly from this point on about his mission. In fact, we're going to see him plainly address his suffering, rejection, and death. Three times in the next three chapters, he does not want this to be missed. Jesus' mission must be done. He must suffer and die for the sins of the elect. And the disciples must hear it now so that they understand it later when they see it with their own eyes. And so Jesus speaks plainly to them about the end of his mission. On a side note, it also just gives us an idea that Jesus is making a statement here that his mission on earth is the most important thing for people to understand. It's the most important thing for us to understand. You know, at times, I think, as believers and sometimes as teachers and pastors, we can get a little bit too caught up into thinking that Jesus is teaching and his actions and his example and his miracles are the things that really defined his mission here on earth and the things we really need to focus on. But do not get me wrong, they definitely are important. But, you know, Jesus was sort of okay with people not quite getting it in his teachings. Kind of, he was okay with them seeing him and sort of wondering about who he was. But one thing that he had to speak continually and plainly about was his mission to come and die and be an atoning sacrifice. Now, every major translation renders verse 31 the same way. He began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer, be rejected, and kill. And we'll consider these three reactions in a moment, but first we must affirm that Jesus himself and the Bible as a whole confirm that the death of Jesus for the sins of the world was necessary. It was the Father's plan for the salvation of his people. It was something that Jesus clearly understood and willingly walked towards. As we study the Gospel of Mark, we've often turned our minds to the literary structure, the painting that Mark is painting as he goes through this. That the first 8 chapters are the rising action. It's the walk up to the top of the mountain, getting up there to the continental divide, and then we reach that midpoint of the book where we were last week, where Peter and the disciples finally see Jesus as the Christ. And now it follows, the second half of the Gospel of Mark is a hike down to Jerusalem. Everything after the confession of Peter is now turning to Jesus' death and resurrection. His mission to be the Lamb of God offered and slain as an atonement for sin. And here Jesus is reminding us and plainly teaching his disciples that although you may not understand everything he was teaching before, if you didn't understand everything you saw on the way up the mountain, it's the journey down that's crucial. Jesus said, you must understand this and who I am and what I came to do. That the Son of Man must suffer many things. Now, as New Testament Christians, the idea of a suffering servant, a suffering Messiah, seems obvious to us. I bet that almost every one of you read at least or heard at least parts of Isaiah 52 and 53 last month as we celebrated Good Friday and Easter. Think of Psalm 51 and 52. I'll pick up a few pieces here. 52:13. Behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up and be exalted. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was marred beyond human semblance and formed beyond that of the children of mankind. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which has not been told to them, they see, and that which they have not heard, they understand. Picking up then in 53:3, he was, again, still speaking of this Messiah, suffering servant. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrow, acquainted with grief. And as from one who men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. He was pierced for our transgression. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. We all like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Verse 10, yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes offering for guilt, he shall see his offering. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hands. Of course, it continues on. And we think of passages such as that. And it seems so clear to us as New Testament believers that that's talking about Jesus. That the Messiah would have to suffer and die. I've talked with several people and they say, how could the Jews miss this? It's so clear, especially they'll cite that, Isaiah 52 and 53. How could a Jew not have heard what happened to Jesus and immediately realize that Isaiah was prophesying this? But in reality, this idea of a suffering Messiah would have been an entirely new teaching to the disciples. And as we read this, if we really want to get into the mind of the disciples, we need to give Peter and the crew a little bit of grace in their slowness to pick this up. You see, it's important to note that the rabbis of Israel did not teach the people about a suffering Messiah. Now, the teachers of Israel understood, and this is they rightly understood, that all the Old Testament centered around a coming Messiah. The teachers in Israel were also diligent to examine all the scriptures as closely as possible to figure out what this Messiah was supposed to look like. And they really understood that there were several pictures of the Messiah that were sort of like a tapestry that you needed to weave together to get this picture. So they understood that the Messiah would be a king, that he would be a shepherd, that he would be a prophet, that he would be a redeemer or a deliverer. There's several other roles that they saw correctly. But there was one element that the teachers seemed to overlook, that the Messiah would be a suffering servant. And the rabbis knew the scriptures, but they never conceived of applying Isaiah 52 and 53, or Psalm 22, or Zechariah 11, 12, and 13, or any of the other prophecies about suffering and atonement that point to the Messiah. But instead, they saw that as speaking about Israel. That's a pretty big miss, by the way. See, the rabbis thought that all these scriptures that we understand as prophesying the Messiah were actually meant to be applied to the nation of Israel. And therefore, when Jesus began to apply these Old Testament prophecies of suffering to himself, the people were rightly shocked. They had never heard such things before. Therefore, Jesus needed to teach them plainly. Christ has come to be a suffering servant. The Son of Man must suffer many things, and he must be rejected by men, particularly by the religious elites. For someone my age, and I think especially that we're in college around the time of September 11th, that we'll always remember what we were doing. And it really was, I think, especially for, I was 21 at the time, and it really felt like the world changed my view and what was going on. And I heard about the first attack on the Twin Towers when I was in the shower. My roommate had a shower radio, and he always had it tuned to the most annoying pop station in Eau Claire, Z100. And I actually first thought that it was like one of their dumb sketch comedy bits or something. And I was just listening to it thinking, this isn't very funny at all. Like, what is this? Because it just didn't seem possible, right? And quickly, when I got out of the shower and saw on the TV what was going on, I realized that it wasn't. But I think about how, and this might be a little bit idyllic, as I said, I was 21 at the time, but I think about the days and weeks and months after that, about how the common tragedy that happened here, and really a common enemy out there, really unified us as a country for a time. That at least for a while, it seemed as though political lines dissolved. The people who really couldn't agree on anything at any time were all of a sudden making compromises and working together as we healed as a nation, as we set a direction for a response. Again, maybe that's a little idyllic, but that's how a 21-year-old experienced it. And something similar happens here that Jesus talks about, but not for the good. For the evil. Jesus mentions being rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes. Now, without going too deep into it, it's important to note that those three syndicates, the elders, chief priests, and scribes, those were the three main power groups of the Sanhedrin. And from all accounts that we read, they could not agree on anything. Except for this. Except for their hatred and desire to kill Jesus. I think of Matthew 10:34 and him talking about, I didn't come to bring peace but a sword, to divide mother from father and brother. Right? He is this dividing line. He does unify people. He either unified for him or unified against him. But there's these groups, right, of powerful men in the Sanhedrin, and they come, they unite, saying, hey guys, I'm ready to put all our differences aside. I mean, sure, we can't agree on angels or demons or resurrection. We can't agree on the role of Rome or the rule of Herod. We can't agree on really anything, except we need to get this Jesus guy out of here. Rightly did Isaiah speak when he said, and he will become a sanctuary and a stone of offense, a rock of stumbling to both houses of Israel and a trap and a snare to the inhabitants of Jerusalem. These power groups uniting to reject Jesus. The Son of Man must be killed. On several other places, Jesus will speak about his death as an offering, as something to which he goes willingly, and that is certainly true, but here he speaks of his death as murder. That he would be killed at the hands of these powerful and evil men. This is all part of God the Father's necessary plan. To send the Son to the earth that he might live a perfect life and then die a brutal death as the only person on this earth who did not deserve punishment. Therefore, dying as an atoning sacrifice, a propitiation for the wrath of God on sin for all who would repent and believe in him as Lord and Savior. And so that stone Isaiah speaks of, that was rejected, becomes the cornerstone of believers, cornerstone of the church. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Messiah must suffer, must be rejected, must be killed, but he will rise again on the third day. He will become the cornerstone of the church for all who believe. And the gates of hell will have no chance against it. Now, before we transition to Peter and the disciples' response, I think about how this was a stumbling block to the disciples, to all the crowds, to all the people that heard it. It was so different than anything they had heard before. But I want to also make the comment and the thought that this might also be something encouraging to us as New Testament believers. It might be encouraging just to think about this list for a moment, to consider that the servant of God who suffered many things, I put that on the outline just quickly here. We often think about Jesus' suffering as happening in that final Passion Week and in the crucifixion. That certainly stands out, but Jesus suffered throughout his life, suffered many things, was rejected by the power and the authority of this world, was treated unjustly, stricken to the point of death. And the truth is, maybe some of you are feeling some of these things. Suffering in your life. Rejection. And it's a comfort knowing that not only Jesus cares when we're in these times of suffering and feeling rejection, but also he's been through it. Through it all and worse, and yet without sin. He's been through all this and more, and he has triumphed. And therefore, as the writer of Hebrews says in chapter 4, verse 15, for we do not have a high priest who's unable to sympathize in our weakness when we feel these things. But we have one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Therefore, we can draw with confidence to the throne of grace that we might receive mercy and find grace and help in time of need. The Son of Man must suffer, be rejected, and be killed, but it is for our good. The Messiah must necessarily suffer, be rejected, and killed. That truth would have shocked the disciples theologically. But practically speaking, it also had major implications. Think about it. If the Messiah had to suffer, had to be rejected, had to die, well, that probably indicates that suffering, rejection, and even possible death was what the Messiah followers were going to have to experience as well. And that's pretty much what happens. And what follows is a picture of what it looks like to be a disciple of the suffering Messiah. These days, you know, if you download a new program or a new app on your phone or you sign up for a service, you usually get an email or a box that pops up that you have to read their terms of service. You know, you have to read this 50-page document with all this legalese and then click a box at the end saying that you agree to all these things. Can I make a confession to you guys? I don't always read all those things. Sometimes I just check the box. Okay. I know that you wouldn't do that, but I want to admit clearly before that sometimes I do that. You know, usually those terms of services are so ridiculously long. But what follows here after Jesus' great statement is, in a sense, the terms of service for following him. The terms of service for a disciple, what a true disciple must do. Now, instead of being 50 pages long, I'm going to briefly summarize these into five S's of discipleship. First, a true disciple must see the mission of Jesus clearly. See clearly. This bases, again, off that living example of the man who's healed halfway and then healed fully in Bethsaida. Peter and the disciples had rightly declared Jesus as the Christ, but they had no clue to the depth of that title. They needed to see clearly, not as men who see trees walking. And so you know the story. Peter takes Jesus aside, probably brimming with confidence after he just got the last question right. And he rebukes Jesus. Now that word rebuke that shows up there is translated rebuke into the English, but it's one of the stronger words in the Greek. Like Peter is really going for it here with Jesus. And he essentially confronts Jesus saying, no way, Jesus. The Messiah, the Christ, can't suffer and die. Haven't you read the Old Testament, this everlasting kingdom? Jesus, I won't let that happen. We won't let that happen. There must be a better plan. Let's sit down together. We're your crew. Let's come up with a better plan than this one where you suffer and die. And Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. Sounds a little harsh, doesn't it? I mean, was it really fair to equate Peter with the devil? All he was suggesting is finding a different way than his teacher becoming this suffering servant. Why does he equate him with the devil? Well, the answer can be found in Matthew 4, 8 through 10, the temptation in the wilderness. You'll remember back to here as the devil was tempting Jesus a few times. Well, here's one of them, verse 8. Again, the devil took Jesus to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these I will give to you if you'll fall down and worship me. And then Jesus said, be gone, Satan. Not the exact words, but very close. Luke actually adds in his account that Satan then departed for a more opportune time. And it seems that the more opportune time was to come a little bit later in Jesus' ministry by influencing Peter to present almost the exact same temptation in front of Jesus. Peter says, Jesus, there's another way. You don't need to suffer. You're sinless. You don't need to be rejected. You're the great king in the line of David. You don't need to die. You hold the power over eternity. We've seen the things that you can do. Let's find a different way. Let's show the people a different way. But the heart of Peter's words and the temptation from Satan in the wilderness are one and the same. The temptation is the acquisition of a throne without the experience of pain, suffering, and death. It is to go against the Father's plan and therefore would not accomplish the will of the Father. And therefore, it was the work of Satan. Next, a true disciple must set their mind on the things of God. Jesus rebukes Peter, and that line is shocking as he equates Peter with Satan in his words. But really, I think the meat of the lesson is found in what Jesus says after the verse, right? He says, get behind me, Satan. But he says, for you are setting your mind on the things of God. Excuse me, you're not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man. How did Peter become this spokesperson for the devil in that moment? Well, it was by concerning his mind on the things of this earth, not on the will of God. You know, my personal favorite term to use for the devil is the Antichrist. And the reason I prefer that term over any of the other ones is because it is a constant reminder, at least to me, to the goals and mission of Satan. You see, often when we think about the work of the devil, we think of it as being exceedingly dark, violent, sexual, voodoo, the occult, mutilation, all these, you know, dark and disturbing things. And don't get me wrong, the devil uses those things too. But more than that, Satan is the adversary, the anti-Christ. And his overall goal is not necessarily to make every person a sexually immoral murderer. No, his desire is simply to shift people away from the truth of the gospel, to shift people to worshiping anything except the Christ. And he's just as happy with someone who's chasing greed or different identities or laziness or whatever it is. Anything that pulls people away from Christ makes him pleased, right? And in a similar way, the devil's not always trying to shift our thoughts to necessarily dark and twisted things. He just wants to shift our mind away from true, good, and spiritual things to a mindset on anything other than Christ makes him pleased. But a disciple must set their minds on the things of God. And we must realize that moment by moment, there is a battle going on for your mind. And that battle is a spiritual battle. Think of Romans starting in verse 8. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on things of the Spirit. For to set the mind on the flesh is death. But to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. And therefore a disciple must be regularly, almost constantly asking himself or herself, am I preoccupied with the things of this world? Or does my heart beat for the things of God? Am I seeking first the kingdom of God as his righteousness? Am I trusting that everything else will follow? Or is there some other priority that drives me? Some ambition that compels me? Some goal to which the best part of my energy and the largest portion of my mind and my thinking is devoted to in this world? A true disciple sets their mind on the things of God. And a true disciple must self-deny. Now it's true to say that basically everything that Jesus talks about in this passage runs counter to the messages of our present day culture. But there might be no bigger one than this, than self-denial and sacrifice. Every advertisement you see in this world tells you to indulge, to splurge, to treat yourself. Life is hard. You deserve this thing. In addition to that, it seems like the only true sin in our culture today is to not affirm a person's self-identity, whatever they choose that to be. Or personally speaking, to not follow your own feelings and passions and emotions and make those your identity. The world tells us that we are no longer bound even by biology or DNA. What we feel is who we are. Jesus says a disciple must be ready to self-deny. And calling the crowd, and I'll even mention here, we think of this as Jesus and Peter, Jesus and the disciples, but remember, he's calling in all that are following, and calling to the crowd, he said with his disciples, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Theologian William Temple once said, the problem is that for all of us, in 1,000 ways, every day, we make ourselves the center of the universe. The problem is that for all of us, in 1,000 ways, every day, we make ourselves the center of the universe. It's a good quote, isn't it? But that's the natural pull, to make ourselves the center of the world, but a disciple needs to check that. A disciple needs to, in 1,000 ways, each and every day, say, no, I will deny myself and choose to follow the servant Christ, the suffering Messiah. A true disciple must see clearly, must understand the truth of Christ. They must set their mind on the things of God. They must deny their passion, their desires, their dreams, and they must sacrifice. Sacrifice even to the point of death. I was thinking of Jesus' words here about picking up your cross and following him. And just to do a little bit of free advertising for the Minnesota Family Council, I've been getting, as a pastor, as a church, they're having their annual dinner sometime in early June, I think it is, and the registration is coming up. June 18th, there we go, okay. And the keynote speaker is Kaylee McEnany, who was the speaker, the press secretary at the end of Trump's time in office. And so they've been sending out these promotions, and it's just a picture of her. In each one of these pictures, she has like a kind of a brightly colored shirt on. But in every one of them, there's this prominent gold cross. It's not like it's not big, but it definitely just sort of stands out, makes a statement. And I was thinking about the boldness of making that statement, but even more than that, I was thinking about how that to us now is a symbol of victory. a symbol of hope. It's this wonderful thing to look at and think on. But that's not how Jesus' disciples would have heard it that day. No one had a necklace of a cross. And to say that was sort of like saying, pick up your noose. Pick up your coffin. Pick up your electric chair and come and follow me. The cross was not a victory symbol. It was the most humiliating way to die. And Jesus said, you need to be ready to pick up that cross beam and carry it to Golgotha, carrying it to the point of death. Must be willing to sacrifice. It's this great spiritual paradox. Whoever seeks to save their life will lose it. Whoever loses their life for the sake of him or the gospel will save it. Jesus says that those who are preoccupied with saving themselves, preoccupied with extending life, being cautious, being safe, Jesus says the very attempt to save ourselves will actually result in our destruction. Of course, it doesn't mean a disciple goes out looking for danger. Of course, this is all shrouded in doing things that promote the gospel and following Jesus. But it does mean that we value the eternal more than the temporal. That we must be willing to trade short-term satisfaction, short-term health and well-being down here for eternal well-being and eternal treasure in heaven. And Jesus gives a lesson in spiritual economics, that even if we could surpass the great wealth of the Elon Musks, the Jeff Bezos, the Bill Gates, or whatever, even if we could increase our power and wealth to the point of the entire world and owning it all, if gaining all that were to cost our soul, it would still be a ripoff, a bad deal that would immediately bankrupt us of all the things that truly matter. What will a man give in exchange for his soul? And think of how literature is just filled with men who have stories of men who have sold their souls to the devil for earthly riches or fame or love, and it always ends up being the worst transaction a human can make. It's insane to exchange the eternal for the momentary. And yet if we sit back, we see it happening all the time in our world. I mean, as parents, isn't that one of the most important things that we're trying to instill in our children as they grow? It's a key definition of immaturity. Those that would take short-term satisfaction over long-term well-being. It's a principle that we try to drill into our children. And Jesus talks about it in spiritual terms. A true disciple must be willing to sacrifice the temporal, the momentary, in exchange for the eternal, even to the point of physical death. Finally, a disciple must shamelessly live for Christ. You see this again in verses 37 and 38. For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. A disciple is not ashamed to be called a Christian. And I wonder, would you be embarrassed if your coworkers, your neighbors, your classmates knew that you were here in church this morning? I'm not talking about being ashamed when we hear of a person or a ministry doing evil in the name of Jesus, or being shy about some of these false perceptions of Christian, but I wonder if you seek your heart, are you embarrassed by the claims of Jesus? Or people knowing that you follow and believe in the claims of Jesus? Ashamed to make a stand that we are not identified by our feelings, or that there is a standard sexual ethic, and to depart from that is as sinful as it is perilous? Are you shy and afraid of people that might find out that you believe that repentance and faith in Jesus is the only way to eternal life? I've quoted this before, but In 2017, the Billy Graham Institute of Wheaton College did this major study of the unchurched. And they found that 51% say that a personal invitation from a friend or a neighbor would be effective in getting them to come and visit a church. 51%. Most of us have at least two neighbors. Why are we not inviting friends and neighbors? Is it because we're ashamed? Or are we ready to live shamelessly for Christ, like we see of the disciples as they move forward? As we see from Paul, as he says in Romans 1:16, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes." Or like our faithful forefathers talked about in Hebrews chapter 11, that is, that they desired and saw a better country, a heavenly one, and therefore God was not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. No math today, I promised. Just a lesson on the upside down economics of the kingdom of God. And as we study Mark, here we are at the top of the mountain, the continental divide of the book of Mark. We have a lesson on what it takes for those who desire to follow Jesus. For those who have desired to follow Jesus, he says, well, it's the way down the mountain. And it means following a Savior who came not in power but in weakness. Not as a warrior, but as an offering for sin to be slain for the elect. And a decision to follow me means that a disciple must see clearly. They must understand my mission. Must set their mind on the things of God. Must self-deny and sacrifice, even up to the point of death. And must live unashamedly for that suffering Messiah that now lives in victory. Are you ready to follow this Jesus?
Let's stand together.
Thank you.
many of us, as we sing those words, we're thinking, really? This is common in a lot of the songs that we sing. We're making declarations, and they are really, I think, prayers, and they are prayers of submission and prayers of faith, desperate petitions. So, Lord, make this so for us. I mean, the end of Mark 8, whoever is ashamed of me and of my words, of him will the Son of Man be ashamed. That's a scary thought. And yet we have this comfort from our reading even this morning. Now to him who is able to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now and forevermore. Amen. You're dismissed.